You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning. It is October 19th. We are meeting together for health education, health in public education, which is our Health Science 300 course. This is our eighth session of the semester, and today we are going to focus on drug, alcohol, and tobacco, and we'll get a lot of content background. But I really would like to invite your participation. We have a call-in number there on the screen for you, and we will also have access to an email. If you'd like to email me any questions or comments, I would certainly like to take those today. In addition to that, you can certainly catch this broadcast archived on YouTube. If you are not able to join us live, or if you'd like to revisit some of what we discussed today. And then, of course, you can always follow us on Twitter. And that, there you go. There you have all the contact information. Please do contact us. Do participate in the class. I really would like to see that happen. I want to hear your comments and your questions. Okay, so last week we finished up our conversation around our third content area, nutrition and physical activity. So we have concluded half of the health education content that is typically addressed in public education. Today we're going to start on our fourth content area, officially called alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs. You will often see that listed as ATOD. Sometimes you'll hear folks refer to it as ATOD, but it's the whole collection of substance use. Our first hour today is going to focus specifically on tobacco use. Our second hour focusing on alcohol and marijuana. We're spending a lot of time on tobacco this morning because across the country, that's actually identified as a separate content area. So if you move to another state, you may see in their health education course outlines, their documents, tobacco is its own content area, and then alcohol and other drugs is a separate. In California, we combine them all together because they are all drugs. But certainly tobacco has some multiple issues that I want you to know a little bit more about. So the question for you to think about this morning is, how does tobacco affect children in schools? We know that tobacco use by minors is illegal, but we certainly know that we do have those underage using tobacco. We certainly know that we have lots of our children exposed to tobacco use in their families and in their communities. So how does that all affect them in schools? So think about that as we go through this, and if you'd have anything you'd like to share with us, I'd really like you to call or email in those thoughts. Okay, let's get started with just some basic definitions so we all know what we're talking about when we throw some of these terms out. The first term I want you to understand is just the word drug. And so when we think about hearing that term, drug, what do you think of? Do you think of illegal drugs, or do you think of prescription drugs? Do you think of over-the-counter drugs? So really, a drug is any substance that changes the function of the body. So certainly we have over-the-counter drugs, we have prescription drugs, we have caffeine. Certainly a drug in some of our favorite drinks. It changes the way the body functions, and typically that's why we drink caffeinated drinks, and we want that change. Okay, so we're looking for that change. We also know that we classify alcohol as a drug. We classify tobacco as a drug. All of the illegal drugs, and we'll kind of go through some of those next week. Even herbs change the way our bodies function, so they are considered a drug. And then volatile chemicals can impact body functions, things like paints and glues. So when we think of the term drug, I hope that you will think in the broadest sense of the term. It's any substance that changes the function of our body. Okay, so now let's go on and talk about drug use. Drug use typically implies that it's the legal use of legal substances. So we're following the directions that a manufacturer may put on an over-the-counter medication. We're typically using drugs for a legitimate purpose. So it's typically considered the legal use of legal substances. Now, we also will hear the term drug misuse, and that's considered the unintentional or inappropriate use of a substance. Typically, I think we think of medications. So if someone has a prescription for a medication and shares that prescription with someone else, that's not complying with the instructions. That's the illegal use of a legal substance. If we're taking more of a particular medication than is prescribed or is recommended in the instructions, that's typically what we think of with drug misuse. So it's an illegal use of legal substances or an inappropriate use of them. And then lastly, we want to think about the term drug abuse. Typically, when we hear that term, these are some of the images we may get. It's the chronic or excessive use of a drug. It may also refer to the intent of use. When someone drinks alcohol for the sole intent of getting drunk, that would be drug abuse. It's typically used when we think of illegal drug use. It's abusing a substance. It's in a legal manner. It's going beyond what it was intended to do if it is a legal substance. So those are the terms that I just want you to be familiar with. So when you hear them tossed around in everyday conversation, you may be able to either validate their use or correct those misunderstandings. Oftentimes we'll hear in community conversations, well, I'm really worried about drugs in our community. And they're really only talking about a certain category. We want to think in broader terms. So I just want you to have that background as we start in on this particular unit, this broadcast and next week. Okay, so let's get to one of the first drugs we're going to focus on, and we're actually going to take the whole hour today. We're going to look at tobacco use. I'm going to provide you a fair amount of background information before we get into how it connects with learning and how it connects with health. So just some background information. First of all, remember back to our very early broadcast when we were talking about the risk factors that the Centers for Disease Control identified as being responsible for a great deal of the preventable death and disability in our country. Tobacco was at the top of that list. Tobacco is addictive. It's responsible for more deaths than many, many substances. One out of every five deaths in this country can be attributed to tobacco use in one shape or another. The use of tobacco products, the single greatest, most preventable cause of death in this country. We have more than 3,900, sometimes it inches up to 4,000 youth under the age of 18 trying their first cigarette every day. So almost 4,000 kids in this country try tobacco every day. More than almost 1,000 become regular smokers every day. So about a fourth of those who try become regular users. And there is cause for concern when you have adolescents starting the use of a substance so early and using it on a regular basis. The Surgeon General's report on tobacco identified that tobacco use typically starts by the age of 16. That's illegal use. It is a legal substance for those over the age of 18. What we know from adult smokers or adult tobacco users is that about 90% of them started under the age of 18. As adults, typically you don't see them waking up one morning and saying, gee, I think I'll start using tobacco. Most young people who use tobacco who are addicted, want to quit but are having great difficulty. So even at a very young age, they recognize their addiction, they're trying to stop, but it is a highly addictive substance. Tobacco is often the first drug used by youth who may also use alcohol and other drugs. For that reason, oftentimes you'll hear it referred to as a gateway drug. A gateway drug does not mean you will use other drugs, but individuals who start out with the gateway drugs, tobacco, alcohol, marijuana, may go on to use other drugs. And we're not quite sure why that is, whether it's a physiological response or a psychological response. But we do know that of students who are using alcohol and marijuana, other drugs, they typically started with tobacco. Students with poorer grades and low self-image may be more likely to use tobacco. Again, listen to the words, more likely, it's not an indicator. And certainly cigarette advertising appears to increase youth risk for using tobacco. We know that there are lots of regulations now about tobacco advertising, not quite as accessible as it was a few years ago, but certainly the advertising out there still appeals to young individuals. Think back to when we've talked about the different types of advertising strategies, using cartoon figures, using adventure, using be one of the gang or be the first one out there to use, lots of different images around tobacco advertising. And we know that in the past it's certainly been a focus toward youth. Okay, so what is the big deal about tobacco? It's the substances within tobacco products that change the way our body works, changes the impact on how things happen inside. The first substance I want to share with you about is tar. Typically, we think about tar as that black sticky substance, construction sites, road repairs, etc. It is tar when you smoke tobacco. Tar is this sticky brown substance that is a byproduct of the burning. And basically, as you inhale that into your lungs, that tar settles within your lungs and it stays there. So if I could have the overhead camera right now, I want to just show you kind of what tar does to lungs. And let's see if we can zoom in on these two white sheets. Okay. I'm going to pull this one over a minute here. Okay, this lung here, very dark brown as compared to the one here. Much lighter, you can actually see a little bit more of the internal structure of the lungs. This is actually a biological specimen. It's a slice of a healthy and an unhealthy lung that's been encased in a plasticized substance. This is actually showing you what tar does inside the body. It basically gets into the lungs, and it's this sticky brown substance that stays in there. This is also the substance that causes the smoker's cough, because anytime you get something into the lungs' natural mechanism is to try to cough it out. And so sometimes you'll hear about the smoker's cough, and that's trying to get some of this out. But after a lifelong use of tobacco, you've got a lot of buildup in those lungs. So again, I want you to just kind of keep these images. And I don't show these as a scare tactic, but more just to show this is the consequence of what happens when we use tobacco and what that tar is. Really difficult to visualize what goes on the inside of our bodies. So these are tools that just help us do that. The other substance you need to know about as a byproduct of smoking tobacco is the nicotine. Nicotine is the addictive part of tobacco. This is the substance in tobacco, however you use tobacco, that creates that dependency, that creates that physical craving for more of the drug. So when we talk about tobacco as a drug, it's really the nicotine that we're referring to as the drug in tobacco. Tobacco is just a leaf that grows in the ground. When you process it and whatever you do to it to then put it in your own body is that use of it. Okay, the other substance that we all need to know about related to tobacco use is carbon monoxide. Now, probably most of you have heard about carbon monoxide. It's not a good substance. You do not want to be around it because basically it can kill you. It will cease functioning of the body. When you are smoking tobacco, you are actually breathing in carbon monoxide. In addition to that as a substance, you're also smoking in lots of other substances. When you look up substances in tobacco, you will find a very long laundry list, and none of them were intended to be put into our bodies. So therefore, I just want to highlight these three as the ones that are pretty serious. Tar certainly slows down the functioning of our lungs. That sticky brown substance inhibits the cilia functioning inside. It settles in the air sacs, so we can't get that exchange of oxygen. Nicotine is the addictive substance in tobacco, and then, of course, carbon monoxide. So that's some general background information just for you on tobacco. So what's the big deal, besides those health effects, for students who use tobacco? Why is tobacco use a problem for students? And if you have some thoughts you want to interject at some point, please give me a call, email me. I would love to hear from you. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and continue while we wait for some of those responses. We certainly know that we have not been able to identify a causation between tobacco use and learning. What we do know is that pre-adolescents and adolescents who are using tobacco tend to perform less academically as compared to their non-smoking counterparts. So our students who are using tobacco may not be getting the grades that their non-smoking
counterparts get. They may not be able to perform as well academically. We do know, while tobacco use may impact that, we know that students who report having difficulty in school, poor grades, not getting along, may be more likely to use tobacco, seeking that out more than students who don't report those difficulties. So we don't know if there's that direct correlation, or somehow we know that there is a link. So certainly as adults working with children, either in public schools, in private schools, in youth groups, we want to make special note of students who are not engaged, who are having difficulty, and just be very aware that there may be a risk of tobacco use in that particular student's life. So we want to be able to intervene. Now, when we talk about tobacco, there are many ways to use it. You can smoke it, or you can take it in through your mouth by actually putting the tobacco leaf. So let's go through some of the ways that we use tobacco. And most of these are going to be pretty familiar to all of you. Firstly, let's go through the smoking. You can smoke it through cigarettes, probably the most available in this country. It is a regulated product, illegal for purchase or use by those under 18. Typically, when you purchase tobacco, you are purchasing in full packages, packs or cartons, and you have to show ID and all of that. Tobacco laws in California are very strict. We know that not only can the individual purchasing the tobacco get in trouble, but the individual selling can as well. In addition to cigarettes, cigars are another way to smoke tobacco. Cigars seem to go in waves of trends. Several years back, it was quite trendy to smoke cigars. And what we actually saw was when adults started smoking more cigars, we saw adolescents also trying out cigars as well. And then there's smoking through pipes. And that seems to be a behavior less seen lately. And when seen, very, very much smaller pockets of the population, and tended to be older men. So I do want to mention that. On the flip side, however, of smoking pipes, now we're seeing quite a trend with what's called e-cigarettes or electronic cigarettes. Sometimes you'll hear them called e-cigs. So a variety of titles. But a recently, new device. And what I'd like to do is show you, we're going to have a little video clip on e-cigarettes and just get a little bit of background information. Then I'm going to share a little bit from a recent Center for Disease Control report on electronic cigarettes. So let's go to that video clip.
After an extensive review tonight, the FDA says menthol cigarettes likely pose a greater health risk than regular cigarettes. They say that's because menthol flavoring is more likely to attract younger smokers, and menthol smokers traditionally have a harder time quitting. As more smokers try to quit, in addition to all the products out there, more are turning to electronic cigarettes. So-called e-cigarettes are surging in popularity, along with questions about what's in them. Our report tonight from our national correspondent, Kate Snow.
The number of people using e-cigarettes doubled from 2010 to 2011, with celebrities leading the way. On TV,
it's got a bejeweled bottom,
and in films like The Tourist.
It delivers the same amount of nicotine, but the smoke is water vapor. Yeah.
They call it vaping, from the advanced models you fill with a liquid containing flavor and nicotine to disposables with LED tips.
I can't even smell it.
28-year-old Kyle Newton is CEO of Sevens Electronic Cigarettes outside Dallas. Newton lost his mom, a lifelong smoker, to cancer, and sees his products as a life-saving alternative.
There's over 4,000 chemicals traditionally in tobacco. We end up with about 12 or more, depending on the flavor.
Flavors like watermelon and chocolate, which critics say attract younger people. At this vapor lounge, there's even a section on the menu called like a kid in a candy store. E-cigarettes are not yet regulated in the U.S., and the FDA warns consumers have no way of knowing whether they're safe.
The marketing is way out ahead of where the science is.
Dr. Pamela Ling says without regulation, it's hard for users to know exactly what's in e-cigarettes.
They think, well, this is just nicotine and harmless water vapor, and what's the big deal? Actually, we know that nicotine is a highly addictive drug, and we don't actually know what the combination of chemicals in the e-cigarettes does to the body.
But at XL Parts in Fort Worth, where employees are allowed to vape on the job, they're convinced they're healthier.
You tried lots of ways to quit.
Yes, and nothing worked until I found this, and then I don't smoke anymore. That's a nice thing to say. I didn't think I'd ever say that.
Chris Putnam says he's more productive, too.
Probably takes, on average, 10 minutes to smoke a cigarette. So if I do that 8-9 times a day.
Which you used to do.
Which I used to do, yeah. I mean, that's an hour of time I'm pretty much not working.
With sales expected to top $1 billion this year, it's no surprise all three big tobacco companies are now investing in e-cigarettes.
Sounds good.
Looking to replenish their shrinking customer base.
There you go, let's try that one.
By jumping on a growing trend.
You like that one?
Kate Snow, NBC News.
Okay, so how many of you have heard about e-cigarettes? I am amazed as I drive down the street just seeing the number of little shops opening up that are selling them and throwing out some new terminology in the community. Okay, so we talked about this surge in use of e-cigarettes. And basically what we've seen is about a doubling in between 2011-2012. 2012, it looks like 1 out of 10 American high school students had used an e-cigarette. And not only the concern is for using them in isolation, but it some of the latest studies are showing that of the regular e-cigarette users, over 75% of them also smoke regular cigarettes. So we're smoking both products. Both products have nicotine. Therefore, both products, they are inhaling this drug, highly addictive, into their body. The thing that we don't know about e-cigarettes is probably more concerning. We don't know the effects of the other chemicals that are used in them. We do know that some of them do contain nitrosamines, and we know that that is certainly not a substance you want to ingest. These are, they're not regulated at this point by the FDA. So we don't know what's going in what product. Certainly they are being advertised as a safe alternative to tobacco, to traditional forms of tobacco. And certainly if you're looking only at the tar issue, correct. They do not create the tar that ends up in the lungs, but there's still that nicotine question. And we certainly know that nicotine is in both. So I don't know that you can actually call it a safe alternative. There is a lot of advertising around e-cigarettes being a way to help individuals stop smoking regular cigarettes. And it is not approved by the FDA as a cessation device. So we certainly want to be a little bit aware of that. And then lastly, we can pretty easily figure out that there is a targeting toward younger individuals. Certainly with flavors like bubblegum and candy cane, et cetera, you're seeing that directed toward youth. So something to be aware of, and maybe even amongst in your own peer group, what's going on there. So any questions about smoking products?
I'm not seeing any come in. I'm not seeing any calls. If you think of something as we go on, please join us. Let's talk a few minutes then about smokeless or spit tobacco products. We've seen kind of an increase in interest in these as more laws have governed where and when individuals can smoke tobacco. Smokeless tobacco typically you find in two different forms. The first we talk about chew or chewing, and it's a very coarse cut of tobacco leaves. Often you see it used in sports, though there are regulations in the sports industry about using it. But typically this is where you're going to see a very big wad of something being put in the mouth between the cheek and the gums. It's very coarse cut, and oftentimes you'll see it sold in fairly large bags, like a sandwich bag size. And then there's the dipping, and dipping or dip is the very finely cut chew, and typically you'll see that in the small cans, Copenhagen Skoll and a variety of other brands. Typically, this fine cut of tobacco product is also mixed with some flavors. You can purchase it dry or moist, depending on an individual's preference. And typically, as with this picture shows, it's just this little pinch that's held in place between the gum and the cheek, and that's known as dipping. What happens is when this tobacco is put directly on that mucosal membrane in your mouth, there's that immediate access to blood vessels, therefore the nicotine has a very direct route and not a very far distance back up into the brain centers. So you get a very quick rush of the nicotine. And sometimes folks think of this as a safe alternative to smoking. Again, you don't see the impact on lungs, but I certainly wouldn't call it safe. And let's take a look at the next video clip that on smokeless is not harmless.
The world is seeing an unparalleled rise in marketing and distribution of smokeless tobacco products. This is how it began. At the turn of the century, fledgling tobacco companies used the beginnings of advertising to sell a product, smokeless tobacco, otherwise known as snuff or chew. Swept from the floors of cigarette factories, this loose-leaf tobacco made its way into the hands of Americans. With names like Little Katie, Climax, and Carolina Bell, women were often depicted in ads carrying home pails of snuff. They used a feminine touch to sell a product. As its popularity grew, so did its packaging. Placing it in containers such as lunch boxes, tin cans, and tubes made it more alluring to the public. They even went so far as showing children enjoying a chew. With key phrases like sun cured, it didn't take long for the idea of smokeless tobacco to stick as a reward for a hard day's work. They even used the Sultan of Swat, Babe Ruth himself, to pinch hit for their product. With the allure of freedom, ruggedness, and the great outdoors, many brands use the backdrop of Western ideology to increase sales among potential consumers. It worked. By showing people hunting, fishing, and playing sports, the deceptive practitioners of the marketing machine learned how to reach people of every nationality and gender. They no longer relied on the addictive nature of tobacco to sell products, but instead struck at the basic fiber of human nature, the ego. With terms such as bolder, stronger, and tougher, the industry uses psychology to combat scientific truth about smokeless tobacco. From Venezuela to India, Sweden and beyond, the far-reaching arm of global marketing has transcended any possible level of constraint and shows no signs of slowing down. with images of couples enjoying snuff and individuals enticing unsuspecting consumers to fit in, these advertisements use their appealing subliminal images to encourage people into trying this harmful product. Using repeated words like Super Amari and Excellent Snuff, worldwide consumers become trapped in the glamorous quality of this deadly product. Now the tobacco industry is using a double-edged sword in marketing. Smokeless tobacco is being portrayed as an alternative to cigarette smoking. They entice you to have a pinch when you can't smoke. Advertisements like this one from India say, when you can't light up, go for the snuff. Frequently, ads are becoming more and more conducive to this type of marketing. These concepts are relatively new, but by adding the phrases, when you can't smoke, serves two purposes. Now they can mention their smokeless tobacco and their cigarettes in the same breath. This type of advertising is more deadly than the original. There's an all-out advertising blitz, placing their products on race cars, lawn chairs, baseball caps, t-shirts, keychains, coins, and numerous other products. But the real truth behind smokeless tobacco is hidden. From the first warning signs of cancer to the devastating health effects it causes, those individuals whose lives have been touched by smokeless tobacco will never be the same. Some of them have paid the ultimate price, their own lives. These images show the real truth behind smokeless tobacco. The devastation this product causes has brought the world to a boiling point. No longer can we sit back and watch life after life be ruined. It leaves a trail of cancer and sickness wherever it goes. But the positive messages are beginning to weave their way into our lives. Where once professional athletes were used to sell this deadly product, they are now turning a new leaf by dedicating themselves to being positive role models. Let's work together to send a message that today's youth are no longer going to be targets of the marketing machine. Remember that smokeless does not mean harmless.
Okay, I like that clip because it not only gives you a visual of some of the products, but it reinforces some of the things we've talked about with advertising and really shown how we can flip some of the advertising to more healthier messages and using some of the same techniques that have been used to sell the products. Okay, so we've kind of gone through how you can use tobacco. Let's just talk about very quickly some of the risk factors and then some of the effects as we go through a little bit more background information for teachers. Risk factors for using. Household access to tobacco. If it's laying around the house, it may be picked up. Low socioeconomic status, tobacco availability, even in the community. Acceptability. I often hear this comment, well, I'd rather have my kids use tobacco than other drugs. Well, I'd rather not them not start on any. Sibling and peer smoking may be a risk factor. The individual who is just that risk-taking student, maybe a little rebellious, maybe willing to be a little bit more defiant, may be at risk for using. Maybe some of them, the students who don't have adequate social skills, behavioral skills, even those who may have body concerns. Oftentimes, using tobacco is seen as a way to avoid eating. So if you're trying to stay thin, that's a good alternative. Those are all risk factors. Doesn't mean that individuals who may have some of those present in their lives will, but certainly increases the risk. So what are some of the protective factors? If these are around, they may help students not pick up the habit. We know that parent and family connectedness is certainly a protective factor. Parents and adolescents who engage in activities together. When parents have high academic expectations, and when parents build and support strong social skills, positive behavioral skills. Those are some of the things that we know protect kids from engaging in risky behaviors, including tobacco. So certainly we look at those factors as two sides of the same coin. There are those factors that put an individual at risk, but then there are factors that, you know, may protect an individual. So certainly we hope that the protective factors outweigh the risk factors. Okay, so let's look at just some of the short and long-term effects of tobacco use. Because I think that helps us frame our messages to kids as we work with them. Short-term effects. We know that tobacco use, however you might use it, causes an increase in heart rate, an increase in blood pressure, causes decreased skin temperature, decreased hand steadiness, increased carbon monoxide levels, bad breath, and it's a great cause of fires and burns. You've got a flaming instrument there at your hand. So when we talk about those short-term effects, those are some of the issues that we can address with students, because they're probably more concerned about short-term effects like that than some of the long-term. So when we talk about when you use tobacco, you know, you have bad breath, it may yellow your skin, it may yellow your teeth, it causes wrinkles. Those are things that are more likely to get an adolescent's attention than the long-term effects. Some of those long-term effects being lung cancer, cancer of the larynx, bladder, esophagus, pancreas, uterus, kidney, cervix, stomach, pharynx, and mouth. So lots of different cancers. Cardiovascular disease and chronic obstructive lung disease, chronic bronchitis or emphysema. So we know typically adolescents, they're invincible, they don't think these things are going to happen to them, so they are less likely to be concerned with that, more likely to be concerned with those short-term effects. If I could, again, have the overhead camera, I have another display I'd just like to share with you, again, because it's so difficult to see what happens on the inside of us. All right, this first, these are plastic casts, basically used from real specimens. This is a section of a normal lung. You can see the blood vessels here and here. You can see it's pretty clean tissue. Lots of small blood vessels there. Okay, if I slide this over, how's that? This is a lung with emphysema. Emphysema basically is the breaking down of the air sacs in the lungs, that very end area that where we see the exchange of oxygen with the capillaries. You also see that it's darkened, and that's that buildup of tar. So we know that emphysema, certainly because you're destroying parts of the lung, is demonstrated by difficulty breathing. And then lastly, I'm just going to show you this. This is representation of lung, a section of lung with cancer. You can still see the very large damaged areas there, but you'll also note an area of an abnormal growth, which we define as cancer. Again, you're still seeing that darkened, tar-filled lung. But those are certainly some of the long-term consequences of tobacco use. But using these with adolescents is not going to scare them into not using. So just so you are aware of that. Okay, so we do know that there are some very specific concerns with tobacco use. And Most often, we are concerned with the individual who's using the tobacco. Will they become addicted? Will there be this buildup of tar in their lungs, which may lead to the emphysema, may lead to cancers, etc.? But I think we also have to worry about secondhand smoke. It's also called environmental tobacco smoke. And you may have heard of the term side stream. And so when we're talking about this, I really want you to think about the young children who are exposed to tobacco use indirectly. Typically what we think of when we think of secondhand or environmental tobacco smoke is that that's the smoke that's exhaled from the smoker. So the smoker inhales and then has to exhale, and it's all this smoke that fills a room. And if you've ever walked by an area where you have a lot of individuals smoking, or you're in a car or an enclosed room, you see and smell that smoke. So when we think of secondhand, the second person to have that smoke is the individual around them. Sidestream smoke is the smoke that comes off of the burning end of the cigarette. So in essence, if you're around someone who's smoking, you are not only exposed to secondhand smoke when they exhale, but you're exposed to side stream just from the burning end of the cigarette. Okay, so what's the big deal? Can you be addicted by being exposed to secondhand smoke? Probably not as big a concern. But here are some of the consequences. You're at increased risk for sudden infant death syndrome in children under the age of 1, acute lower respiratory tract infections, asthma, chronic respiratory symptoms, middle ear infections, and long-term exposure may actually lead to an increased risk for heart disease and lung cancer. So being around an individual who smokes puts us at increased risk for many severely debilitating kinds of diseases. And it is something that those of us who work in public education need to be aware of. So if you are working with children who come in smelling like cigarette smoke, cigar, pipe, whatever, you do want to be concerned about them. If you have students who show up with chronic bronchitis or who seem to have greater difficulties with asthma, in middle ear infections, etc., you may want to just think about that tobacco, that secondhand smoke being an issue there. Let's go to a very short video clip on secondhand smoke entitled, "It's Like They're Smoking."
I smoke while I'm watching cartoons. Yeah. I have my first cigarette of the day when I get up. We smoke in the car on the way to school. I smoke while I'm coloring. I smoke during my nap.
When you smoke around your kids,
I'm down to about a pack a day.
It's like they're smoking. Secondhand smoke can hurt their lung growth and permanently damage lung functions.
I tried quitting. I need to try again.
Okay. I don't believe that any individual who smokes around kids does it to intentionally harm them. But it is like they are smoking. Those individuals around the smoker are breathing in those substances. And at whenever time that adult is using. So just a couple of good images to remember. Certainly, I think appealing to a parent's concern for the health of their children is a great way to help parents start to think about either quitting or smoking away from them. Okay, so I've given you lots of background information about tobacco specifically. What I'd like to do in the next few minutes is just highlight some recommendations that have been made for schools and some guidelines for teachers. So let's go through that. And as I go through, again, think about our question this hour. You know, how does tobacco affect children? But also think about, are these things in place where you may be working in schools? And have you considered these in your own interactions with children? So let's do the recommendations for schools first. And this is, these recommendations come out of the Centers for Disease Control and the Surgeon General's office, really taking what we know about tobacco and what we know about effective programs. And the first is that we want to develop and enforce school policies on tobacco use. And typically, in California public schools, you will see no tobacco use signs, not just no smoking, but no tobacco use on school property. You will see signs like this one, the no smoking beyond this point, a certain perimeter around parks, public buildings, particularly governmental or city buildings. So we want to decrease the exposure, is what we're trying to do through policy intervention. We also want to provide instruction on short and long-term consequences of tobacco use. So in schools, we have a policy, but we also want to have that direct instruction and really focusing on short-term and long-term consequences. We want to provide that instruction from kindergarten through high school. It's never too early to start. And while these recommendations are for school, I think I would just add we can or certainly start in preschool. What's healthy to put into your body? What's not healthy? What's healthy to be around? What's not healthy to be around? We also want to provide some program-specific training to teachers. If we're asking teachers to provide this instruction, we need to not only provide them with some curricular materials, but some training so that they have a good understanding and background in tobacco and effective strategies. We also want to involve parents and families in supporting school-based programs. So letting parents know what we're doing with tobacco prevention, why we don't allow parents to use tobacco on campus, so that they see that we're really focused on the health of their children and we want to partner with them and we want to encourage them to do the same. And then also in schools, we want to support cessation efforts among students and school staff who want to quit using tobacco. In California, our tobacco use rates are very low, but we still have staff members who use tobacco. And the ones who still use typically have used a very long time. They have tried to quit for a very long time and are having difficulty with it. So we want to support their cessation efforts. We know that young people who do smoke, many of them do not want to continue in that behavior. But because they are addicted to the nicotine, have a lot of difficulty getting off of it and quitting. So we want to offer that to them as well. So those are some recommendations for schools. Now let's take it even into the classroom and some guidelines for teachers that I would encourage you to think about. I think when we as teachers start talking about tobacco in our classrooms and in our lessons, inadvertently we may say things, we may believe them, but we need to watch how those words come out of our mouths. And I think the first I would encourage you is not to imply that kids are bad if they smoke. They are taking a risk in smoking. They are exposing themselves to a variety of chemicals. They're putting themselves at risk for lots of health consequences. But they are not bad kids. I think we need to separate the judgment, good or bad, from the behavior. We also want to be very careful about another word, and that's saying that smoking is dumb. Many teachers have said, oh, I don't know why people smoke. It is so dumb. If you're a student in that teacher's classroom and you're hearing about the adult smokers in your life being called dumb, really difficult to listen to. So I think we need to watch our own language. I think we need to stick with some of the conversation around consequences and healthy or less healthy. We certainly do not want to encourage kids to denounce smoking at home. I think sometimes in our fervor to excite kids and to get them to advocate for non-smoking, we may even encourage them to go home, and then they make a scene at the dinner table, they throw away the tobacco, whatever. We need to be very careful. We do not want to encourage that kind of behavior, because that's not really a partnership with parents. We want to be very careful about telling young children that using tobacco causes death. When the very young little ones hear that, they go, I've been in a classroom where I've had kids burst out in tears. As we're talking about it, I realized, oh my goodness, there's somebody in their family that uses tobacco and they are fearful that they are going to die. So you can focus more on the death factor as kids get older and understand those long-term consequences. But with young ones, I don't think we need to go there. However, with the older ones, we certainly don't want to overdo the warnings of death, because invariably you will have students in your middle and high school classes who say, my grandpa is 98 and he's been smoking since he was 12 and he's fine and it does not cause death. So don't go to the extreme. Again, I think that goes back to my conversation about focusing more on some of the short-term consequences. And then, of course, as teachers, we want to make sure that we do not give mixed messages. If we are using tobacco, our kids are going to know. Think back years ago when teachers were allowed to smoke on campus, typically in the lounge. In classrooms, we had tobacco prevention lessons going on, yet as kids walked by the teacher's lounge, they could smell the tobacco smoke coming out from underneath the door. Very much a mixed message. So we do have to, once again, think about ourselves as modeling healthy behaviors for our students and making sure that our words in our instructional lessons match some of our behaviors. So that brings me to the end of our first hour this morning. I don't think I've had any emails come in or phone calls. Let me just make sure, if anybody has a question, a comment about tobacco, you want to call in, I would certainly like to take that now. Or if you are at your computer and you want to email me, I will certainly respond before we go on break. And I'm not seeing anything come in. Okay, if you're in the middle of that email, keep typing. We'll take it right when we come back from break. What I'd like to do is give you about a 10-minute stretch break and think about now, as you go into that break, going beyond tobacco, and how does substance use and abuse affect children in school. So we're going to kind of broaden our thoughts after break and look at a couple of the other drug categories. So we will see you in about 10 minutes. Get up, stretch, move around, and we'll start back in 10. Thank you.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find inside the gym.
Thank you. the amount of students that go into college. Kaiser.
My name is Cheetah Chin and I'm currently majoring in liberal studies. I'm involved with Toro Productions and I love working with DHTV here on campus. I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills because of its small class sizes.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This is student life.
I'll have more right now, but...
Go! Sweet!
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
My name is Rosie McCann. I've been a part-time lecturer at Cal State Dominguez Hills for 14, 15 years and loved every minute of it. Because of that, it's a great honor to have my family's collection of Huichol paintings and huipils for display here at this extraordinary library. My mother and stepfather, Charlotte and Les McCann, collected huipils from Chiapas, Oaxaca, the Yucatan in Mexico, and from Guatemala. These huipils are brilliantly colored, sleeveless tunics that can be either waist or ankle length, sometimes used on a daily basis and sometimes used only for ceremonies. The designs on the huipils are very specific to particular regions in both of those countries. My husband, John Melvin, and I collected Huichol paintings. These are paintings done by the Huichol Indians in Tepic, Nayarit. To make a painting, a design is made on a board of wood over which is laid beeswax, and then brightly colored yarn is used to fill in the designs. Originally, these were done just for religious ceremonies. Were very small and symbolic in their designs. I am so grateful to have found this extraordinary home for my family's collection.
My name is Ileana Gutierrez. I'm a communications major here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I have my own radio show at KDHR, our on-campus radio station. The reason I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills is because of its beautiful campus and cultural diversity.
I basically took the distance learning course because I'm trying to get my California credential. I'm an out-of-state teacher. It's very convenient. I took last semester the health course from Joanna Chase, and I found that to be to my liking. I could study, relax, do it casually in the confines of my home.
I took one of the distance learning classes basically for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or, you know, if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and kind of watch it at my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch the videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center, and I would recommend this to a friend.
My name is Mauro Rosales Jr. I am a digital media arts major. I transferred from Santa Monica College here to Cal State Dominguez Hills. I chose Dominguez Hills due to the fact that I heard they had this great program for the behind the scenes camera and production television work. That's digital media arts, so I decided to come here. I like Dominguez Hills due to the fact that the small classes, the campus is big, and the staff is very, very helpful.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, welcome back. This is our second hour of Health in Public Education. This is our eighth broadcast, and I am Robin Sinks, your instructor. We want to continue our discussion that we started in our first hour focusing on tobacco. We're going to focus more on alcohol and marijuana the second hour. But I just wanted to give anybody a chance who maybe had a question, thought, or comment regarding our first hour's question, how does tobacco use affect children in school? We want to see if anything came in over break. It does not look so like we had anything. Okay, well, our phone lines are still open. Our email address is available if you have something specific to tobacco use. But now let's just think a little bit more broadly in how does substance use abuse affect children in schools. And our second hour, we're going to focus on specifically alcohol and marijuana use and the impact of those substances on children. So just as we started off that first hour talking about the Centers for Disease Control, and they identified six typical behaviors that really impact death, disability, and disease in this country, tobacco is typically identified as the first. We've just talked about that. Inadequate diet and physical inactivity. We talked about those the last 2 weeks. And then the next three are kind of a smattering, not in any particular order, but one of them being alcohol and other drugs. So we are still very much focused on those health behaviors that really impact the health of our country, and specifically what we see in schools and what we can do about some of those issues in the school level from preschool through high school. So let's start off the hour just with a little bit of background information on alcohol. Alcohol, oftentimes we do not think about as a drug because it is a legal substance to purchase in this country if you're over the age of 21. However, given our definition of drugs that we went through at the top of the first hour, we certainly know that alcohol changes the way our body works. So therefore, it is a drug. And in this case, alcohol is considered a depressant. It slows things down. Alcohol is typically categorized into three different types, beer, wine, and hard liquor, or distilled spirits. And oftentimes we have this image, and I'm going to scoot over just a little bit, that the distilled spirits or the hard liquor, hard alcohol, is worse than having a beer or a glass of wine. And typically what we want to reprogram ourselves to thinking is that there are equivalencies of alcohol in different drinks. A 12-ounce beer has the equivalent amount of alcohol as a 5-ounce glass of wine, as a 1.5 fluid ounce glass of 80-proof liquor. So, and they're on the screen lists a few of those. So sometimes folks say, well, I'm just having a glass of wine, or I'm just having a beer. That's not so bad. Well, it depends on how many glasses of wine and how many beers you have, or if you're ordering a cocktail, how many 1.5 fluid ounce shots are included in that drink, as to how much alcohol you're actually putting into the body. Typically, alcohol is commonly abused by adolescents. You know, we talked about tobacco being one of those gateway drugs. Certainly, alcohol is considered another one. We talked about, or in the first hour, risk factors for tobacco use being accessibility and norms stating that tobacco use is acceptable. Well, in particularly in California, it's probably less acceptable to use tobacco than it is alcohol. And because there are many more individuals who use alcohol than use tobacco, alcohol availability is probably much greater, much easier for students to get access to. Certainly, the physical effects of consuming alcohol are significant. But we want to keep in mind, and you're going to hear me refer to alcohol in a couple of weeks, because we also know that alcohol is associated with unintentional injuries as well as intentional injuries. Because we know that alcohol use, not only among adolescents, but anyone who's using alcohol, is associated with vehicle crashes. We know that there is a link with alcohol and violence, crime, depression, suicide, even things like falls and burns and drownings. So certainly, when we are using alcohol and depressing our central nervous system, we're not able to make judgments as quickly. Therefore, we may not hit the brake on the car as quickly as we need to. We may not be able to adjust the direction of the car by turning that wheel quickly enough, or we may overcompensate and turn too far. We know that
Oftentimes we think if I'm using depressants, I might be a little bit more lively at a party. So sometimes we even think of alcohol as a stimulant. It's not a stimulant, it's a depressant. It's basically that it depresses our inhibitions. Sometimes those inhibitions may be depressed and we may actually express violence when we might not have done that without alcohol. And certainly if we are in a depressed state of mental well-being and we're battling depression, using a depressant is going to actually exacerbate that. So certainly there are far-reaching consequences of alcohol beyond the individual who's using the substance. There are, as many of you may have heard this before, particularly in your driver's education course, several factors that influence the absorption of alcohol into our body and into the bloodstream and therefore central nervous system. Certainly the concentration of alcoholic beverages. The more you drink, the more is going to become available to your body, and you're going to see a significant impact. So we know that the rate of consumption, how quickly we dump that alcohol into the body, has an effect. And if we've had any food in our stomach and in our system to slow the absorption down, we know that individuals who weigh less we'll see a more rapid absorption than individuals who weigh more. It's also impacted by one's drinking history and even gender. Male and females tend to absorb differently, females absorbing a little faster than males. So we certainly know that alcohol changes the way our body functions. And depending on what type of alcohol we're using and how quickly we are using that will impact the rate of absorption and therefore some of those linked behaviors and consequences. Let's just think again, specifically focusing on short and long term. Again, because when we teach alcohol prevention to students, again, we want to avoid the scare, the doom and gloom, and present it more in the reality of short-term and long-term. So I've alluded to several of these already, but let's go through them. Short-term effects. Perception and motor skill is certainly impaired. You do not want to be driving any type of machinery, including a car, when you are drinking. It also affects our perceptions of what's going on. Increased heart rate and blood vessel constriction. While it is a depressant, it is also associated with sleeplessness. Typically after an individual drinks some, they can go to sleep easily, but they do not stay in that state of sleep, and they do not get that good sleep that their body needs. Often awaking and not being able to go back to sleep. Increased risk-taking, reduced inhibitions, decreased fears, feeling overly relaxed. And then, of course, there's the morning after, the hangover. After you've done all of this to your central nervous system, it goes into a rebound, and certainly you are not feeling well the next day. And alcohol is a water-soluble substance, so it takes some time to get out, and no matter what you're drinking or eating, it's time that's going to get the alcohol out of our bodies. And the hangover is almost our body's way of shutting down to allow that to get out. And then for individuals who use alcohol over the long term, you will see certainly the nutritional impacts. There is no nutrition in alcohol, but a lot of calories. So you will see individuals exhibiting, just the fact that they're not getting nutrients then and there, but over long term that has some significant effects. Okay, long term effects. Cirrhosis of the liver, gastrointestinal disorders, decrease in calories, in the good calories we need if we're focusing on alcohol, cardiovascular disease, high blood pressure, and then a state of alcoholism. Lots of long-term effects, and then, of course, the cirrhosis of the liver, the heart disease, the chronic alcoholism certainly leads to disability and death. There are certainly legal consequences which fall under short and long-term effects as well. And if I could have the overhead camera again, I brought some images so we can kind of see what happens to the liver. Just as we saw the lungs, now we're going to take a look at liver. These casts were made, again, from real specimens, though they are not the tissue itself. This is a normal liver. The liver is just basically a large glandular organism in the body, and it regulates everything, and it pretty much cleans out everything. This is healthy color. We see, some of the blood vessels here as well. Typically what you'd see in a healthy liver. Okay, if I slide this over, let's try and get this in the picture. This one's a little harder to do. This is liver showing hepatitis. And hepatitis is just basically an inflammation of the liver. And again, hepatitis can be caused by viruses and bacteria, sexually transmitted diseases. And what happens is the reason we have this here talking about alcoholism is remember those decreased inhibitions, decreased decision making. Sometimes we do things that we might not do otherwise. When we are under the influence of alcohol, that may lead to hepatitis. And then I did mention cirrhosis of the liver. This is an image of a cirrhotic liver. Again, you'll notice just how different it is from that normal specimen in the fact that you see it actually in cirrhosis it becomes hardened, and you see these knobs, these it just kind of swells a bit, it gets very hard, the blood is it's much more difficult for the blood to go through to be cleansed. The scarring basically makes the liver inoperable. The liver can't do what it's supposed to do for us. And that's certainly seen, it's seen in other diseases, but certainly an effect of alcoholism. So again, oftentimes we don't quite know what we're doing to the insides of our body, and these kinds of images do help. So we know that alcohol affects our bodies, we know that it's easily available to us, and just as we talked about drug misuse, there are times when people intentionally binge drink a lot of alcohol fairly quickly. And that has some other effects as well. So what I'd like to do is show a little video clip that really focuses on teen girls and binge drinking.
You know the saying, every parent's nightmare?
Get out of the fast lane!
Welcome to the nightmare in overdrive.
Going about 90 down I-5.
Holly was a teenage binge drinker. On this night, she's barreling down the highway after a few too many drinks.
I'm gonna vomit.
I'm not proud of the drinking and the driving. I think it's so stupid.
And yet, that's what alcohol does to you.
Yeah, it's poison.
Holly's exploits are featured in the documentary Faded, which offers a sobering message for unsuspecting parents. According to surveys, one in every four teen girls don't just drink, they binge, meaning five or more drinks in one sitting.
Surveys say that 90% of parents
say, oh no, not my kids.
They're ignorant. Well, okay. I think denial is extremely powerful. I think a lot of parents don't want to believe anything negative about their kids.
Rebecca Thomas had no clue the extent to which her daughter Erin was secretly binge drinking. One night she wound up at a party with older boys she didn't know that well.
So I thought, I'll just take a couple drinks, I'll relax, I'll get to know these people. But then that turned into, you know, I'll take another shot and I'll take another shot of this.
So how many drinks do you think you consumed that evening?
About 4 beers and I want to say 10 to 13 shots.
10 to 13 shots on top of that?
Yes.
How did you stay conscious?
I didn't.
Rebecca, as you're sitting here listening to this, 13 drinks?
Yeah, this is the first time I'm hearing the whole story, actually.
13 drinks can kill a person.
Yeah.
Erin then got into a car with her boyfriend, who was pulled over for DUI. And Erin was taken into custody for underage drinking. Her mother got a heart-stopping call.
The officer said, are you Rebecca Thomas? And is your daughter, you know, Erin Thomas? And I just thought, oh my gosh, is she dead? I was just panicked.
And shocked. Often, binge drinkers aren't the campus misfits. They're just as likely good girls, under enormous pressure, just trying to fit in. Erin says she first began lying to her mother in eighth grade.
It was about me wanting to make a decision and knowing that I wasn't going to be able to do anything unless I did it behind her back.
You wanted control.
Yes.
Often, underage bingers secretly pregame, pounding stomach-turning quantities of alcohol before the school dance or the big game where alcohol is strictly banned.
Shotgunning 5 beers over a couple hours could be pretty common.
Little kids, they don't even like the taste of alcohol.
No,
they're just chugging
it. Disgusting. And you're encouraging each other. You're sitting there going, it's okay, just do it, just fast. Just here, and telling each other tips on how to drink it faster so you don't taste it.
Take a look at the hit movie Project X, Hollywood's take on a high school party run amok.
Is this big enough to be cool?
For girls, alcohol has the added danger of giving them courage to act out sexually and then providing an excuse for the risky behavior the morning after.
80% of teenage pregnancies happen when the girl is drunk. Does that surprise you, that stat?
No, that doesn't surprise me.
Why?
When the girls are drunk and the guy starts to push it to that limit, the alcohol gave you the liquid courage to start, but not to stop.
Not only does the alcohol make them more promiscuous, it makes them more vulnerable.
Well, yeah, because they don't choose their partners well. So then we see STDs. That's when we see them being assaulted sexually. Or they pass out, and now the males take advantage of them.
Shelley Campbell has treated all sorts of ghastly consequences during her 40 years as a trauma nurse at Legacy Emmanuel Medical Center.
It's about 3/4 of the injuries, all injuries, tripping over a curb had alcohol on board. Or people heard there was a party, this happens frequently, and show up, and they can't get rid of them. And so we got knives pulled, we've got guns pulled, and then we have violence.
But beyond getting injured, according to a new study, teen girls are more likely than boys to damage their brains because they weigh less and their livers process alcohol differently. Brain scans show less activity in the areas of memory, spatial awareness, and decision making.
How much have you had?
5, 7, 8 shots.
As the documentary shows, it starts young.
How many of you guys care if you damage your brain?
Which is why Nurse Shelley visits middle schoolers before puberty and the anxiety that comes with it hits.
Once that brain's damaged, it doesn't get better.
It turns out you're 5 times less likely to abuse alcohol as an adult if you can just delay drinking till after age 15.
We're going to do some skits.
So Girls Inc. of Portland, Oregon targets 12-year-olds with exercises designed to prepare them for the inevitable temptations.
Hey, do you want to go to this party with me down the street? That's going to be totally dope. What are we going to do? You know, take some shots, get buzzed.
And give them the weapons they need to resist peer pressure.
We're going to have so much fun. Well, how about we just go have a girls' night at my house some other time then?
Okay, sure, whatever, bye.
Looking back, Holly says perhaps the best prevention is helping a young girl beat back her escalating insecurities.
What do you say to the 14-year-old you?
I tell her that she's beautiful and she's capable of doing whatever she wants to do. And I don't think I knew that.
You don't need that alcohol.
Yeah.
Without.
I could be cool without it.
Okay. Some good insight to some of the gender differences, but also this whole link with alcohol use and mental health, with self-concept and self-image. So certainly, I want you to kind of think about that as you work with students in youth groups or schools and what you can do to address some of those issues with them. In addition to working with students around their own use of alcohol, we need to be very aware that many of the students that we work with may come from families where there has been significant use of alcohol, or an individual in the family is an alcoholic. And oftentimes we know that the risk of alcoholism does run in families. So we need to be very aware of that as we work with our kids. Statistics commonly stated that nearly 1 out of 8 American adult drinkers is an alcoholic or experiences problems with the use of alcohol. So if 1 in 8 are having some difficulties, that certainly translates into the chances of many of our students living in those kinds of families and seeing the impact. Because alcoholism not only affects the alcoholic, but the entire family. And oftentimes, children living with an alcoholic are going to demonstrate a variety of signs and symptoms, including guilt, anxiety, embarrassment, inability to have close relationships, confusion, anger, and depression. So a variety of symptoms might be seen. And I want to thank one of your classmates for writing in on the discussion board some very personal comments about alcoholism and really trying to connect with students, maybe being a little bit more sensitive because of past experiences, but being very aware of students in the classroom, being able to connect with, to develop some close relationships with, and then also to connect those students with counseling staff on site and even community agencies. I think those are really important things for us to do. We do know that children of alcoholics benefit from very specific teacher behaviors, including how teachers can help them develop some autonomy, some independence. Alcoholic families are very tight and codependent. We want to encourage that independence. We want to help our students who are coming from those situations develop very strong social skills, develop friendship bonds with adults and students, gaining positive attention, having a positive outlook on life, goals and a vision, and then just helping them with day-to-day coping strategies. You know, what they're going to be able to do to stay safe should they go home and find things awry. So I just want you to keep that in mind as you kind of consider the children that you work with. And with that, I would just want to check in. Do we have any questions? Any comments from anybody on that? Okay. Well, I'm going to take the last few minutes of this hour of our broadcast to go over a few bits of information about marijuana and about, in general, substance use in schools. So let's now switch over from thinking about tobacco and alcohol to considering marijuana. And again, I referred to this as one of the gateway drugs. And I think we are living in a day where there is probably more conversation about marijuana and more mixed conversations about marijuana than I think there ever have been.
Typically, marijuana is the first illicit drug that students will use, most likely. I'm not saying it always is. But, and I think that's because most young people do not believe that marijuana is harmful. I have heard, as I've gone into classrooms, students say, well, you know, tobacco is treated with all those chemicals and it's not healthy. We've done a great job of tobacco prevention in California. But, you know, marijuana is healthy, it's natural, it's a plant from the ground. Well, it is a plant from the ground, as is tobacco, but certainly there are chemical compounds within that plant that we need to recognize. And the main active chemical in marijuana is THC. When marijuana is smoked, that THC goes quickly through the bloodstream to the brain, and then it's redistributed. With less than 30 minutes, you've got a redistribution. And THC is a fat-soluble drug, so it tends to stay in the body longer. Now, you know, part of our conversation today, this thing that the students are really feeling like it's a healthy alternative to tobacco, that it's not harmful. And many students, even as Anna pointed out on discussion board, was that many people do not think it's harmful. Actually, they think of it as a medicine. It's a cure for cancer. It's something that your doctor can prescribe for you, because now we have entered this phase in our society where we are looking at medical marijuana. So is there a difference between medical marijuana and street marijuana? As far as chemically, no. And so our kids are confronted with lots of different messages now and lots of advertising around marijuana with the marijuana medical facilities. So again, let's go back and look at consequences of use and help our students frame their decision making with some of this information. So let's first look at short-term consequences. We know that use of marijuana does impair short-term memory. So that makes it harder to learn and retain information, particularly complex tasks. So if we're asking our students in schools to do some complex problem solving, whether that's in math or it's in science or whatever, you're going to have much more difficulty when under the influence of that THC. And remember, because it's fat soluble, it's there well beyond when you've actually smoked that. There is slowed reaction time. There is impaired motor coordination. So certainly our students who are involved in sports, in athletics, that's going to have an impact on them. Anyone behind the wheel of a car is going to have a problem. Anyone using any type of machinery may be at increased risk for injury. We certainly know that another short-term consequence of THC and marijuana use is altered judgment and decision-making. Very similar to what we see with alcohol, in the fact that it may lead to some unhealthy decisions, some increased risk in sexual encounters, engaging in violence, etc. We do know that THC impacts and increases the heart rate 20 to 100%. So if you have heart issues already, that may exacerbate them. And certainly it alters mood. In low doses, it's that euphoria, it's a calmness. In high doses, it can lead to anxiety and paranoia. So that's kind of the cadre of short-term consequences. Long-term consequences, again, compounds the ability to quit smoking cigarettes, partly a behavioral thing, partly because of a connect between the substances and the addictability of nicotine. You may not be able to move forward with some of those kinds of things. Memory and learning skills are affected over long-term. And again, increased upper respiratory consequences. You're again inhaling a hot substance into your lungs, so it is going to affect the cilia. It may lead to chronic bronchitis. It may lead to emphysema, just like we saw in the lung sections earlier, and then head, neck, and lung cancers as well. We do know that the smoke in marijuana contains 50 to 70% more carcinogens than in tobacco smoke, so our increased risk for cancer. We do need to be aware, as individuals working in public education, of synthetic marijuana, often referred to as spice. This is becoming a little bit more out there. It's a wide variety of herbal mixtures that produce similar effects to marijuana, but it is not marijuana. It's marketed as a safe, healthier alternative to marijuana, and sometimes you'll hear it as spice, K2, fake weed, fire skunk, moon rocks. Those are some of the names that are out there. And what we really have to look at here is the false advertising behind this particular substance. We will see on the packaging or in the conversations with people talking about natural drugs taken from plants. Well, they are still psychoactive. But with this, there are a multitude of synthetic drugs added to the product itself. Sometimes spice is sold as an incense. Sometimes what it really looks like is potpourri. It's just a variety of different substances. Most people smoke it. Some people will actually infuse it into hot water and drink it as a tea. We see some of the same effects that we see with marijuana, but we do hear more reports of the psychotic effects, the extreme anxiety, the paranoia, the hallucinations. And then what we've also seen in poison control centers is that they're reporting extremely rapid rate of heartbeat, vomiting, agitation, confusion, the hallucinations, and even associated with heart attacks because of its impact on heart rate and blood pressure. So when you're hearing or you're hearing your students talk about a safe alternative to marijuana, certainly we want to provide them with some accurate information on that. And I think that's what we need to keep in mind as we go through even the next few years, because certainly it's a national debate. Marijuana is illegal at a federal level, but it's legal in some states. There is the medical marijuana issue, and we've got just lots of information floating out there. And I think we have to help our students understand how to access valid information and how to make some decisions around that based on accessing that information, looking at some of those influences. And my guess is that those of you who are working with middle and high school students are certainly hearing your students talk more about marijuana in light of the social changes around it, and probably quite a bit of conversation around alcohol. So again, you need to keep that question in mind. How do these substances affect your students in school? So if you have any questions or comments, we have just a few more minutes in our broadcast. I'd certainly entertain those. I think lastly what I want to do is just go back to some connections with alcohol and drug use and learning. We talked a little bit about tobacco and learning, and not that there's a direct correlation. However, we do know that there are a few more direct correlations with alcohol, just because we know that alcohol has some significant effects on the brain, on the central nervous system. Many of the drugs do affect memory loss and the ability to retain the information that students are learning. So we do know that there is that impact in schools. We do know that there is a correlation of, again, students who are having difficulty academically in using substances, is it because they are using substances or they are having difficulty academically and then using substances? So again, something for us as adults working with students just to be aware of, so that we can show our concerns to students and express our availability should they have questions, should they want to talk. And again, one of the most important things we can do as teachers when we believe some of our students are having difficulty is refer to our school nurses, our school counselors, or our community agencies that are working with students around those issues. We certainly know that there are a multitude of risk factors. And so when you survey your classroom or your group of students, think about these risk factors in general, not so that we, you know, start labeling our students, but just so that we raise some awareness. We know, we've already mentioned the school risk factors, that academic failure, these are the kids that aren't really committed to doing well in school. We know that there are some individual and peer risk factors. The rebellious student, the one who's maybe a little bit more antisocial, the one who is willing to take more risks, to be involved in maybe some negative behaviors. One of the greatest, most significant indicators of a student using substances is that that student has friends who use. Oftentimes we want to say, oh, we come from a family or this or that, but knowing a student's friends tells you a great deal about that student. And when I work with parents, I encourage them to know who their child hangs out with, who they spend more time with, because again, peers who use are a significant risk factor. We've already alluded to some of the family risk factors, any family history of alcoholism, any family use, parents who have favorable attitudes. I'd rather you party at our house where you are safe, is not helping students. Just as preaching at students and being overly assertive in controlling, it does not help. Lots of family conflict may in fact increase the risk for use. And then we also have some of our community risk factors, and everywhere from poor economic conditions to families in communities and communities that are in transition. Lots of movement, no connections able to be made. Communities that favor substance use and availability of substances in the community. So when we look at those risk factors, again, we just want to be aware and know that there are then on the flip side protective factors. Really engaging students, increasing that bonding at school, increasing bonding at home, really helping kids feel connected, feel special, feel empowered. And those connect back with some of the prior broadcasts that we have addressed. So I think I am now down to one of our last segments for this hour and this broadcast. And that is just looking at some recommendations for schools. And again, thinking about this as a teacher. When we are thinking about schools and the substances and students using and communities, we really find that once students and once individuals come on to a school campus, there are lots of laws about not being in possession or use of those substances or the paraphernalia that are associated with them. And in the past, many states, many school districts have had a very strong no tolerance kind of policy where you know, one infraction and you are out. You are sent to another school or another district. And what we find now is that we're really looking at those no tolerance policies and saying, yes, we do not tolerate the behavior. We do not tolerate the breaking of law. So we do have some law enforcement involvement in the consequences therein. But I think more and more what we're seeing is that rather than sending students away, sending them to a new school or to a new district, we're really trying more to connect them to services to help them with the issues surrounding their substance use, whether those are mental health issues, physical health issues, behavioral issues, learning disabilities, really trying to look more at what's causing, what's at the root of all of the substance use, and providing some strong parameters for students, but really engaging them and trying to address that rather than sending them off. I think over time what we've seen is that students who are sent away are now completely disconnected to their new community, their new school, their new classes, and very often drift toward individuals at that school in those classes that are also using. So we haven't really helped the student. So we're really trying to find a balance between applying consequences for use and providing support and help for students. So that's just a little bit of the discussion about policy. And then I just want to reiterate a little bit about instruction. And we know that substance abuse instruction does differ between elementary and middle high school. In both, we are certainly trying to provide students with accurate, current information about substances, providing more specifics as students get older. We are looking at certainly helping students analyze influences, both internal, you know, that curiosity, values, feelings, thoughts, as well as external, friends, the media, family, culture, community. We also want to help our students learn how to access information, accurate information and valid information. So how do we weave that in? Identifying for young students specifically, who do you go to when you have a question? You see something happening or you hear something about tobacco, drugs, alcohol, marijuana, who do you go ask? With older students, we're going to look more at giving them more information so they can be providing accurate information to their peers, but also how to evaluate information they hear in the media. How do they evaluate articles on the web? How do they evaluate the ads and the images they see? So we just do it a little differently. We certainly want to focus on the benefits of not using substances and talk about all of the things you can do when you don't use substances. So giving them positive alternatives, ways to connect and feel parts of groups, ways to feel good about themselves without using substances. We certainly want to teach at both levels, elementary and secondary, strong communication skills, including resisting those negative pressures. We talk about resisting peer pressure, but I also want to just highlight that many students get their first substance from a family member, an older sibling, a cousin, maybe even just sneaking it at the house. So how do you resist pressure from somebody in your own family? And really looking again at decision making and goal setting. How does the decision to not use help you achieve your goals? How does the decision to use substances interfere with you achieving your goals. And then I think when we talk about consequences, some of the biggest differences being we're really focusing more on short-term consequences across the board, but really looking at those longer-term consequences as we work with older students. So those are just some general recommendations for schools. Next week, when we come back, I'm going to talk about a few more substances, give you a little bit more background information, but then we're also going to look at some of the drug prevention curricula that has been used in the past, as well as some of the curricula that we're currently using and show some effectiveness, or at least promise of effectiveness. So a little bit more about classroom discussion will continue next week. So at this point, we are about ready to close up for the morning. I do want to remind any of you who are students watching in the classroom in this course right now that the second exam will be available to you at noon today. The exam window will close Monday evening at 11:59. There are 50 items on that exam. This time you will have 75 minutes, so 1 hour and 15 minutes to go through that. And you certainly will not need any more than that. I believe you'll take much less. So be sure that you are on and prepared for that exam. And then we'll just keep moving on through the semester. Next week, we will be back here, same time, same place. Please join us. Please check Blackboard for not only content that you'll need to take a look at in preparation for next week, also discussion board, and also look under assignments because you'll have another assignment coming up very soon. So with all of that, here's wishing you health, peace, and happiness. Have a wonderful week. We will see you next week. Thank you.